This talk is about ThinkTech. You've already seen ThinkTech in action in TechWorks on Monday. And today we'll be talking about more precisely about ThinkTech. ThinkTech is available in PDF Tech and ZTech, and in the next TechSlab distribution, and also in MicTech. It is not activated by default. You have a new command line argument and a new tech primitive, and if you set them to 1, ThinkTech is activated, and if you set them to 0, it is deactivated. Let us see the context in which ThinkTech was created. First, there was Tech, of course, then PDF Tech. Visual Tech is a commercial software by MicroPress. It is available on Windows. And it claims to have the first engine to have embedded abilities to synchronize between the tech input and the PDF output. Textures is also a commercial software on macOS. It is by Blue Sky Research. It has an embedded ability to synchronize between the tech input and the DVI output. From the macro point of view, there is the source LaTeX package by Alexander Simonik, who is the author of the WinEdit shell on the Windows platform. And this package allows to synchronize between the tech source and the PDF, the DVI output, with a good DVI viewer. Aiko Obadik wrote VPE to synchronize from the PDF output to the tech input. And finally, I wrote PDF Sync, which is a package based on ideas by Piero D'Ancona, an Italian fellow. And this package can allow us to synchronize between the tech source and the PDF output. And it is well known for the macOS users because quite all PDF viewers on macOS support PDF sync. And finally, iTech Mac 2. This is the front end I write for macOS 10. And this front end contains a PDF viewer so that I know how to write a PDF viewer. That makes strange things. Let us now tell a few things about PDF Sync, how it worked. First, given a word in the tech input, for this word you have a file name and a line number. This is the input record. Once everything is properly typeset, this file name, this word appears in the output at some page number and some location in the page. This is the output record, and synchronization is just the link between the input record and the output record. And how PDF Sync was working? In fact, this link was made by a unique tag. Why a unique tag? Let us recall how tech works. Tech reads the input file, then passes the text one line and after the other. And it passes the text, it expands the macro, and when there is no syntax error, it makes internal computations, it breaks line, put lines into paragraphs, put the paragraphs on the pages, and then when the pages are full, it ships out the pages. And the exact locations of the text and other material on the page is known only at ship out time. But in the meanwhile, Tech has completely forgotten what was the file name and the line input of the origin of the material text. So, in order to track this information throughout the typesetting process, I had to use a unique tag. And the information was stored in special nodes that were created automatically at every mat, every display, every paragraph. But using a special node is extremely dangerous. There are mainly two problems with special nodes. The first problem is that adding special node to the list can break the line breaking mechanism. In fact, the layout of the document can be different whether you are using or not the PDF sync package. This is exactly a problem that was encoded by the source LaTeX package and the source special option of the PDF tech engine. The second problem is that PDF sync is not compatible with some extra packages. For example, it was not compatible with the preview LaTeX package, and David Kastrup had to put an end to PDF sync, make some correction to PDF sync in order to have both packages work together. But unfortunately, this change was not possible for other packages, unfortunately useful packages. This is the second problem. The third problem concerning this design is for developers. In fact, the link between the input and the output is not a one-to-one mapping. In fact, it is a multi-valued mapping. For one kind of input, you can have different outputs. And the developer who wants to support PDF sync in the viewer must choose the correct mapping, which is not so easy. So let's see now how SyncTeX addresses these problems. And the best way to do this is to see a demo. This is a lightweight PDF viewer I wrote while developing SyncTeX. The example is a very well-known example. So let us scroll to an interesting page, this one, for example. And if I double-click here, okay, you see in red the point where I clicked. And in the left part of the window, you have page 46, which is not very interesting. And here we have line 5 to 22, and just below the file name, which is math.tech. This is the input file name. What is really the blue region? In fact, the blue region is just an HBox. And here you have all the HBoxes that tech creates. You also have the VBox. And this is all information that SyncTeX writes, records. It is not sufficient to synchronize. In fact, there is also additional information. Let me zoom in order to see things. Okay. Bigger. Okay. Yes, we can see here. You have two numbers in front of each box. The first one, here, 110, is the number, a unique number associated to each file. And the second one is just a line number. But here you can see that all the boxes share the same line number, is 532. It's bigger than the 522 that was here. Why what this? Because those boxes were created when tech applies its line breaking mechanism. They were created late, too late. So this information is useless for synchronization. Okay, let's forget the H boxes. I must find something else. And fortunately, tech also creates automatically kernels for interword spacing and also glue nodes. And those nodes are created very early in the typesetting process, so the SyncTeX information is accurate for them. You've got a different file type here, and here the line number is correct. So here I can use those nodes to synchronize. What does the magic behind the scene? In fact, SyncTeX writes an auxiliary file where there is many information. Let's go to the top. First, you'll see the list of all the files. It is a LaTeX file, so there are many, many files open. And each one is recorded.
with a unique number. And using this number, I can recover the file name. Oh, sorry. I try to scroll smoothly. Yes, the interesting part starts here. And let me zoom in. Okay, this is the information stored in the SteamTech output file. You have, for example, the magnification, the offset, which can be different depending on your using DVI or PDF. And then, for each page, there is a record here. The record starts for page number one. And you can see that page number one starts by, here, a VBOX. The first number is the file tag, the second number is a line number, and after you have exactly the dimensions known by tag, the horizontal position, then the width, the height, and the depth of the box. You can see that inside that box there is another V-box, inside another V-box, and then an H-box with a left parenthesis. And here if I double click correctly here, you have the whole H-box, and this H-box contains a kern. Let's see how the two parts work together.
Is round bracket H-box and square bracket vertical?
Yes, yes. And K for kern, G for glue, a dollar for mat, mat nodes, etc. Let's see something here. A random. Okay. Ah, it's not a good one. Zoom out. Okay. Yes. Well, it's not very interesting. Okay, this is the H-box, and this is when you can make the link between the ThinkTech information and what appears in the window. Well, this is not a concrete implementation. Let's see a concrete implementation in iTech Math. This is different than TechWorks because I add a layout to have a better synchronization. This part is beta, so it doesn't work really as expected, but it works quite well. So here is the beginning. If I select a word here, on the top you have a red arrow that points to a word, and it is exactly the same word on the top and on the bottom. On the top is a preview, and on the bottom the text window. And on the opposite direction, if I click on the M of the comment here, you have the M of the comments here. This is really fine. Well, this has limitations. If I try to find the div, okay, I find the div. You have the div at the top and the bottom. But if you try to synchronize from the PDF, okay, it doesn't work here, just because the word different contains a ligature. The double F is a ligature, so I have to take this into account in order to synchronize in this direction. But so it is not complete, but it works quite well. It is much better than a rough implementation of ThinkTech support. Let's turn back to the presentation. So, ThinkTech in Tech Life, all this started last year, in fact, when in Eurotech, Han told that he planned to implement PDF Sync support into PDF Tech. And last year, he sent me an email, and he had a first attempt to support synchronization in PDF Tech. He sent me the source and told me, it asked me to write a PDF viewer to support this. Unfortunately, his ideas were completely unusable.
So I learned to code in Web Pascal, and I made changes. And after many nights,
I had a new version that I submitted to the PDF Tech list, the developers list, and they agreed that it would be usable. Then Jonathan took the patch from PDF and translated into something that ZTech could understand, and he could make it work with DTech. And in return, he sent me a change file. Unfortunately, at that time, I didn't know what was a change file, so I learned what it was and how to write change file myself. And finally, we ended up in the actual TechLive implementation. More detail about this implementation. There are 2 points. We can say first that this is a segmented implementation. All the syntax sources are split into different files, and each file is targeted for one task. First, you have memory management. Remember that syntax must record the file name and the line number, so we need extra memory. In this task, we declare the extra memory. Then we have to deal with this memory. The main thing is when things should be copied here, what should be initialized or not. This is not extremely complicated, except that I had to browse all the tech code to recognize every piece of code concerned by syntax. And finally, things might be different depending on the tech engine used. The second point of the implementation, it's an orthogonal implementation. I mean, syntax is meant to be shared by all the engines. So it's not reasonable to have one piece of syntax in PDF tech and the same piece of code in ZTech. So you have to share the code. And actually, all the syntax related code is gathered into one directory, and absolutely no code lies in the engine sources. The second point is that syntax must not break the typesetting process. Syntax is an add-on. So it must be possible to build the engines with syntax or without syntax. For example, imagine that a developer wants to add a new feature. If this feature interacts with syntax, things might be broken. So he'll have to develop his feature and also adapt syntax to his feature and make some change, revert, and at the same time, change syntax. It's much more comfortable to build the engine without syntax, to develop the new feature, and once everything is done, adapt syntax to his feature and not the opposite. And actually, this is done by a make file, and I learned to make files. And actually, you can see that there are only three locations. This is a make file to build PDF tag. And there are only three locations where there is syntax. This is a make file to build with syntax. And if you don't want syntax, you just replace with syntax, but without syntax, you rebuild and you have an engine that doesn't contain anything related to syntax. Next step is syntax support. How third-party software can support syntax? There is now a syntax parser library that I wrote in C. This is just the code that I extracted from my PDF viewer. It is a C library that is actually embedded in TechWorks. It is also embedded in Sumatra PDF. Sumatra PDF is a lightweight PDF viewer on Windows. It is, the author is Christoph something, and it is William Bloom who added support to syntax. In fact, he sent me an email a couple of weeks ago, and he said to me, okay, I was frustrated because on Windows, no PDF viewers were supporting PDF sync. So I worked hard and I implemented PDF sync support in Sumatra PDF. And I answered, this is very good. I have good news for you, but also bad news. The bad news is that PDF sync is dead, and the good news is that SyncTech is there. And in fact, I sent him the SyncTech parcel library, and 2 days later, he had made a patch for SyncTech. And of course, I take Mac to implement SyncTech support. Another method is simply to pass the SyncTech output. If you run PDFTech or ZTech with SyncTech minus one instead of SyncTech one and on the command line option, then you have a text output file that you can pass with regular expressions. And actually, OSTEC and WinEdit do pass the SyncTech output just because for OSTEC, some people don't have a PDF viewer supporting SyncTech. For WinEdit, some users really want to use Acrobat instead of Sumatra PDF. But in fact, WinEdit and Sumatra PDF worked well together. Finally, this is not the correct method. The SyncTech output file should not be passed directly. In fact, there is now a new command line tool, also called SyncTech, which is an intermediate controller between the text editor and the PDF viewer. The text editor will ask the SyncTech tool to ask the PDF viewer to view at some correct location. And if XPDF is a... Well, in the next version of XPDF, and with the SyncTech tool, the synchronization might be possible on Unix boxes, provided that the SyncTech command line tool is not buggy. Finally, let us summarize. The benefits of SyncTech, it's more precise. Well, more precise than what? More precise, okay. And the fact that it's deeply embedded in the tech engine is really a benefit. There's no longer special nodes, so no problem of like breaking, no problem of package incompatibility. There's no more package for synchronizing. And as a side effect, this is the same for DVI, XDV, and PDF. There's no difference between them. And it does not rely on an external format, so you don't have to manage a package for plain, macros for LaTeX, macro for context. And finally, it is much more easier for developers, except the one who made the SyncTech parcel library. Finally, what comes next? First, the column number. Well, in the input record, I was talking about the file name and the line number, but what about the column number? It might be useful for display equations where there is no word. But in fact, I'm afraid this is something very difficult to implement because tech does not know nothing about the column number. So I'm afraid the tech source must be adapted in a very difficult manner. So this is something I would not support. And also due to the fact that in iTech Mac 2, I demonstrated that you can synchronize with words, with characters already. So this is a route I wouldn't take. So the second part is use of the SyncTech data. In fact, we saw that in the SyncTech output file, we had all the dimensions of the boxes. And in particular, we have the depth of the boxes. So if you you use some PDF output and you embed it into HTML, you can have a vertical alignment using the depth of the boxes given by SyncTech. Okay, but there are many, many other things to say. But it is time. Well, it's time, yes. And I'm grateful to the PDFTech developers team, ZTech, TechLive, iTech Mac 2 developers team, at least with the people I had contact with, they were very, very patient and efficient. And finally, wow! No, you can hear, there is no fire alarm.